Take a deep breath. Let it out slow. Long exhale. And begin at the crown chakra. I'm going to speak these words so we just don't have to try to remember. I am that I am. I am. It thinks. She feels. He wills. We share. I belong. All right, now let's stay silent while we do this. Let's not speak. Okay? If you can interrupt me by raising your hand, and then I'll call on you and you can speak, ask a question. But this is just to keep the space more of a healing space while we do this. Right, so as you begin placing the stones slowly and deliberately in position on the person, you will be, let me walk you through it. Don't start until I talk about it. As you begin placing the stones on the person, you'll deliberately do it. You'll feel, you just do it with a certain purpose and a sense of that you're really having the intention for healing for this person. The divine blueprint is the pattern of our perfect health and well-being. It's the pattern that we were meant to incarnate, or we are destined to incarnate. So to be in resonance with the divine blueprint is to be in perfect health. And our habits are what take us out of that. So this is an attempt to help, to ask the stones to help us establish that pattern, reestablish that pattern. If you each have a necklace, you should both wear them, yes. This lady here, you're my partner. Would you be willing to lie down up here with me so I can do this up here, or shall I come down there? Come up here? Somebody bring the mat. All right, so the first things you'll place when the person lies down are the two selenites. You'll put one above the crown chakra, just sort of at the top of their head, and then you'll put the other one at the root chakra. The person should spread their legs apart a little bit if they can. If there's someone wearing a skirt and they can't do that, you can put it down below their feet. But otherwise, just like a little above the knees, pointing up, and the crown chakra at the top, look, pointing down. All right, so you'll start with the selenites, and then you can just go through the list and slowly and deliberately place the stones on the person. Work from the root chakra upward after you've placed the selenites. Visualize each stone making the appropriate energetic connection with the person's physical and non-physical body. Hold in your heart the image of the person receiving the layout. Imagine that person in glowing, radiant health. Look through the person as you place the stone, seeing the form of his or her divine blueprint of health, guiding it into perfect alignment with your physical form, with the physical form. Notice any dark areas, if you see those sorts of things, and visualize healing light dissolving them. hold the two images of the physical form and the divine blueprint as one image. Sound in your heart the word compassion as you do this work, and just keep on sounding it if that feels good to you. Stay in a state of attentive receptivity and notice what comes into your awareness. You may want to note any messages you receive for the person. If you're receiving the layout, close your eyes and relax your body. Do the heart alignment as we've just did, and take a few slow deep breaths with long exhales. Bring attention to your heart and inwardly sound the words, "My healing." As each stone is placed on or near you, welcome it and breathe it into your energy field if you're receiving it. Let your inhales draw the currents inward and allow your exhales to circulate the currents back to all the stones. Let each breath recycle and increase the beneficial flow between you and the stones. Let each breath pay relaxed and clear attention to the sensations you feel and to any messages that come to you. Sound in your heart the words, "Body joy." Let yourself be carried by the music that we'll be playing and healed by the loving attention of your partner and the stone beings. All right, I think we're ready now. So, deep breath, everybody. Christine, you can play the music. And when you're done putting the stones on the person, just sit there next to the in the chair next to them and hold that pattern of their healing and well-being. Blend it with your own. Thank you. if you receive this healing, then just be really slow to come back and let yourself kind of drift back in. Again, we'll start by doing the heart alignment, if you're placing the stones or if you're receiving them. If you're placing the stones, sound in your heart the words love, ascension, as you place the stones on the person. Oh, it says, make sure the person is holding the two Anandalite stones. Wow. Intuition and planning come together. As you begin placing the stones slowly and deliberately in position on the person, work from the root chakra upwards. Visualize each stone bringing more and more light into the person's body. Allow yourself to see the person transform completely into light. Let that visualization occur for you as you look at them. And sometimes it helps to slightly blur your eyes while you're doing that, because it allows the subtle things to be seen, because you're not, your attention isn't captured by the physical form as much. Pay receptive attention to your partner, holding him or her in the safety and warmth of your heart. I felt a lot of that during the healing thing that you were just doing. Okay, if you're receiving the layout, you'll be closing your eyes, relaxing, you'll do the heart alignment, you'll take deep breaths and long exhales, bring attention to your heart, and inwardly sound the words, my light. As each stone is placed on or near you, notice the current of pure light that flows into you from the stone. Breathe the light in as you inhale and allow it to radiate out as you exhale. When you can see your body filled with light, sound in your heart the words, I love. Feel the love and light flowing through you like new blood circulating everywhere. Pour your attention into the light and allow it to carry you upward. Sound in your heart the words, I am light. So you'll begin at the beginning of receiving, you'll sound my light. In the middle, as you see your body filled with light, you'll sound the words, I love. And as it's carrying you upward, you'll sound the words, I am light. The person giving the stones will be sounding the words, love, ascension. All right, let's start doing the heart alignment. You don't need the words anymore. Just put your attention in each chakra and bring that intention of alignment there. Ready? Deep breath, exhale long. Do your alignment intention from the crown downwards, both of you, giver and receiver. All right. You can put the music on, Christine. All right. I think let's do some sharing about what we went through just in the last couple of hours. Is that okay with you all? Okay. So my layout partner did really well, and she's going to tell you. Tell her what happened. Go right to your mouth.
Yeah. I saw a crystal city. All trees were made out of crystals on the top of a mountain that was supposed to be holy man. If I reached there, so I would see him. And I was going in up, and there were some white, some being in a white robes, were chanting something, and I saw this being, but I didn't talk to them. I was going up, and a light was shiny. It was blue light, and was changing to some pink. Light, and I was admiring this light, going up, and it was finished. Everything, I didn't reach top of a mountain. It was quite interesting.
You get an A in Ascension. You did really well. Thank you. Who else would like to say something about their experience giving or receiving either the healing or the Ascension layout? Who wants? Anybody want to speak? Oh, back there, yeah.
Right there. Hello.
Yes.
That was probably one of the most intense experiences, receiving the Ascension layout. I was reminded of a time that I forgot about where I cried out from the heart, the May Day. On the rim of Bryce Canyon, I had shed tears, and I said, I want to ascend. And they said they heard me. And I was encircled in light, and I was witnessed by angels as I lifted up. And the bliss and the joy is indescribable, truly. But especially when I came back down to earth with this light and touched, felt the earth in this canyon particularly, everything was white. Everything was alive. The rocks, there was angels in the rocks. There was light everywhere. And it was indescribably beautiful, the light going through my body and into the earth. And giving with the anandolite, and is that, yeah. they moved themselves pretty, they had a mind of their own. And what they were doing was incredible, the grid work. And I've had the experience of stones moving on their own, but nothing like that. And it was absolutely beautiful.
Thank you. Who else will speak? Okay.
I'm not the best with the English language, but with the love ascension, my whole body just filled up with white light. I mean, it was so bright, pure white light. And I felt, sort of feeling the connection with everybody in the room, like slowly but surely. And it, like, we were all connected. And all together as a room, we went up into the earth, above the earth, and we spread out and we circled the earth. and we all shot down beams of white light.
Wow. That's what I saw. I remember that. Who else will say something to us? It's good if you can share some of these things. I think it helps everybody. I'm going to assume if you don't say anything that nothing happened, right? There's one. Oh, okay, where you are and then her.
On the first meditation, the blueprint, I felt like the blueprint was laying on top of me, like it was just being infused. And the second one, I felt like my body was going up into the light body.
Wow.
It was just one was going down and one was coming up.
That's right. All right, there's another.
This has to do with giving. Okay, when I was giving the Ascension, what I saw was Peggy in this like Greek-Roman era of wearing like this gold helmet, this gold, whatever they call that, okay, but being female, and she was riding a chariot. Okay, and I could see the chariot going up into the sun. Okay, which I thought was really awesome.
Yeah. Who else wants to speak? We got someone else? Oh, good.
In the ascension process, I experienced going into the dark hallway of my birth family's house. And it was very dark and very ugly and ugly things in it. I experienced then my father taking a nap in the living room and going into the living room and putting all of these crystals on him. And at that point, my mother was then playing the piano at the other end of the hallway. So my father's at one end getting the healing. She's doing the music. And then the doors start opening, and there's a flood. There's like then a window that opens at the top, and this flood of light comes into the hallway. My brothers come out, open the doors, and the light floods in. They're full of light, and all of them are shining light into the hallway. So now this very dark hallway is now filled with light. And I then move upwards above that in a lotus position.
Wow. Anyone else? Yes, Piper's got one.
I just wanted to say that the most joy and bliss for me was when I was doing the crystal layout on my partner, Wynn, and I could feel her going through the process, and it was pure joy for me.
How many of you could feel that with your partners? Wow, almost everybody. I could too. How many of you, when you were receiving, received something that you would relate to the intention of the exercise? Oh, good. So that's everybody. That's great. How many of you could sort of feel your divine blueprint moving into alignment? That's great. How many had an experience of light in the second one? Oh, 100%. All right. Anyone else want to say something? I want to hear more if you want to share. But we'll get a mic to you.
The meditation we did before we went to lunch, and I didn't get time to say it.
Okay.
It's just earth was shedding tears of gratitude for the work that's being done here. Hmm.
Thank you. There's a hand here.
When we were doing the blueprint process, I was encompassed by a grid of pearly gray that was like the Taurus net, but a network going around my body. So my body was kind of encompassed in this larger human form Taurus net. Mm-hmm. It was nice.
So anybody else? Oh, back there, okay. How many of you feel like you need a nap? All right, anyway. Go.
Thank you. I had, in the first one, I had a disagreement with somebody just recently. And last night in the shamanic journeying, I was requesting to see one of my highest guide. And she was not coming forth last night, but she sure came through right now.
Hmm.
And to share what the miscommunication was within myself, of course, which was really very grounding for me. And then she also showed me, it was just really neat to see her or to feel her presence, because I've been asking for that for quite a while. And then as I was looking at my daughter, psychically I saw Joan of Arc. And she's had a strong connection with Joan of Arc since she was a young girl. So that was unexpected, yeah. And she is a warrior, so very interesting.
I'll say.
Yeah, thank you.
Sure, anyone else? Over here. Go right to her, I guess, yeah? Sorry. And then you can come back if I overlook somebody there.
Who am I going to?
Okay, so I kind of went a little ETville, and was met and greeted by a beautiful feminine energy, but very tall, dark skin, long, lanky hands. The eyes were just almond-shaped. And walking through a corridor, I'm like, is this my door? Is this my door? And she's very patient, didn't even open up her mouth. We were speaking mind to mind. And then we went up and ascended further on a spiral staircase and opened up a door and brought me into a room, and all these items were made of energy. So the table, what looked like a table, was made out of light, and a chair was made out of light. And then I was met by my, revisited by my gatekeeper, spirit guide. And it was, again, tall of form. I had to look up to it. And he put his mind to my mind and just started downloading a lot of information. It said, don't worry about what you're downloading. You're going to get it when you need it. Mm-hmm. And I felt everybody here has downloaded a lot of information, and you're going to be using it at the right time, the right place, and the right situation. So I'm very, very grateful. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Was that the second exercise, did you say, or the first?
Second.
Yeah. All right. Who else? Over here. Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't see you. You'll be next? Okay. So over. Who? Raise your hand again, whoever I pointed to. There she is. Okay.
On the first one, I saw some past lives. You know, at first I questioned, because the first one was pretty awful, but it turned out okay. And then I saw the crystals just aligning. I could see the light from one to the other, from root to crown. And then I thought, it's like, there's these grids all over the room, so why don't I connect all of them and connect everyone's hearts? And I could see, like you're saying, about connecting to the axial grids, the work grid. And I thought, well, there's a labyrinth out there. Let's get them. So everything was all working synergistically
in
the first one. The second one, as soon as you put the phenocyte on my third eye, I started seeing sacred geometry. That was so cool.
That's phenokite.
And then, of course, I kept going. The light was incredible, you know, higher than I'd ever been before. The light was liquid light, and riding the light was like going, watching a waterfall going up instead of down, riding the light. And then I saw like little gold circles, and I was going up through the circles, and I felt as though I was done riding the light, and then I was riding sound. It just kept going. So it's very beautiful.
Thank you. And good thinking, connecting everything. It's good. I forgot. How about you?
There's a lot to remember. I had more of a general question, and you just mentioned to us that this is the last exercise that we'll be doing with our bag of borrowed crystals.
Yes.
And I thought that perhaps, and you had this in mind, I'm sure, but perhaps there's a way that we could each thank our bags of crystals and say goodbye to them in a special way. And I wondered if how they were having a bath later, because that was the question that they asked me.
Well, we have a big jacuzzi at my house, and I thought I'd get in with them. I think I'm going to do that. Maybe I won't get in with them, but we'll give them a jacuzzi bath with Epsom salts. Epsom salts seems to clear me pretty well, so I think we'll try that. It's a good thing you asked, though, because in truth, I hadn't figured that out until you asked me. Yes?
On our first journey, it was kind of long, but I will make it brief because it can be brief. I experienced like all my DNA leaving my body through my crown chakra and going out in the universe and untwining and shattering and dancing and retwining and then untwining again and recombining in different configurations, and it was just dancing all over the universe joyously saying, we're going to make you new.
We're going to make you new. Whoa. Follow that pattern. It is the birth of a new world and a new body and a new consciousness that we're midwifing and calling in and volunteering for and giving up to. So I love that. Who else?
This didn't happen during these last two meditations, but after she mentioned the DNA, I thought maybe I should share this. In one of the meditations, I went through a red door and went into an area where there was a spiraling iridescent light of double-stranded DNA, and it was beautiful. It was just spiraling up and all different colors, and towards the top it was whiter, and towards the bottom it was lower, and I got the impression it was a tree, and the top, and I can't tell the difference between imagination and whatever, but there were leaves on the top, kind of like a tree, and I got the impression that a zestulite was at the top, and as it was spiraling around the DNA, it was, and the color gradation changed to rosacea at the bottom, and I went over, and I hugged the tree. And I felt as if the azestulite energy was coming through my body and giving energy to the earth. And there were other people that I saw as sparkling points of light also around and hugging the tree.
Oh, that's great. You know, one thing I'll say about these visions is they're both imagined and real, in my view, in the sense that the overlap between the spiritual and the material is that liminal area that Jung called psychoid and that other people in shamanic traditions might call the shamanic world. It's matter, and its representation is metaphoric, and its density is much finer than matter in our world. So the spiritual impulse of intelligence from the other circle utilizes what's in our consciousness for the imagery to appear. So if it feels like it's your kind of imagery, it doesn't mean that it's, quote, just your imagination. It, I believe, means that the beings who see your consciousness are communicating to you visually, because language isn't really the way it works between us, although it can. But there's a lot richer display often with imagery. So that's my answer to you don't know whether it's imaginary or not. Who else? On the floor.
On the ascending one, I had, as she placed each stone, I had the vision of color. Like the first one was the root chakra, so I had the red color, and it was spiraling. So as she laid the stones, each color started spiraling together and together until I had purple, so I had the whole rainbow going. And then she went back to adjust a few, and all of a sudden I got the big burst of white light, and I went outside my body, and I'm floating above, and it was utterly fantastic. I had angels flying with me, and I didn't want to come back. We were laughing and singing, and it was just wonderful.
Thank you. All right. If there's nobody else with a burning desire, we'll finish up here. Did Piper? Did Justin bring in those parcels? Are those the ones I asked for? Okay. You got one on each side of the door. Okay. So what's going to happen as you leave, if you will? It'll take a little couple minutes, but we're leaving a little early, so you'll have time for this. If you can roll up your mat, and there should be a rubber band that was left there. Don't do it yet. Let me talk to you first, okay? As you roll it up, find that rubber band and put it around there, and then as you go out, you can leave the mats on the floor. We'll pick them up, but put the necklaces in those bins and the selenites in the other bins. Now, I saved something good for you. you know how much Azeschalite and Rosafia mean to me in terms of the gestures they make for this new world we're building and the new emergence of the union of the divine male and female in this planet, the incarnation of the light and the incarnation of the love as one. I want you, when you go home, if you're willing, to spread this a bit. So what I've done, what Kathy and I did, was that we put together packages of an Azeschalite stone and a Rosophia stone and the little cards that explain them and a little piece of paper that explains what you're doing with them, because what you're going to do with them is give them away. Yeah. Yes. We'll give that back in a minute. You take a bag as you go from the bin on either side of the door. In the bag, there'll be five pairs. So you've got five people to give to. All right? Let's put it out there. Thank you. Thank you so much for your hard work. Thank you. I suppose you're still wondering why I called you all here. I can't remember. Tonight we're going to do the crystal arts and crafts, I like to call it. And we're going to be making our own energy tools. So what's been getting passed out are the little sheets that tell you what go on the different types of wands that we make, and wands and templates. Everybody is going to get enough parts to make two selenite wands and two selenite meditation templates or body layout templates. You're going to get two long wands and two squares of selenite. Okay? So To go on those, you're going to glue the stones on those in a pattern that you select. Now, the stones that you're going to glue on there depends on what your choices are. Okay, the pieces of paper show you different options. So there's about 7 or 8 options on the paper, different sorts of combinations. Are you with me? Okay, so you can look at that and think, well, I want to make these 4, and I want to make these 2 as wands and these 2 as meditation squares. And then when that happens, you're going to get all these stones in little containers on your table, and we're going to bring you glue and little sticks to put the glue on with. And you're going to then choose your pattern and make your pattern and use those stones to make the 4 that you want. Now, in the past, I haven't given people any choice. I've just said you're making this one and this one. But I thought this time let's just make a little bit more optional for everybody, and you get to choose to make what you like.
We're making wands out of stones.
You don't have to add. We're done with the set.
Well, I can use these.
Oh, it's going to fly everywhere. Okay. Thank you.
Yes, I am the glue man. I'll be glad to serve you.
Blue Cuckoo.
Yeah, that's good.
This happened, and I'm not sure if I have all the stones. Like, this is a blue wand, this is a sand.
Yeah?
This is a sand. This is a paper. This is a crystal bronze.
Uh huh.
I think this is a gold.
Yeah, that's right.
Let's
do you want my gun in the picture?
Ready? Oh, he looked away. Oh, thank you.
Give me your first name, though.
Melissa.
And you just found out that you're cousins?
Really good.
It's great. Here it is.
Well, I was just saying that there's another project after this.
Oh, right. Okay.
Right, and it's prayer sticks. To hold our prayers and to amplify them and to sit on them. So we've got stones and feathers and glue and beads and wire and all kinds of stuff to make on these sticks that we brought for you. That's maple off our land. Okay, so here we go. I think that might be 10.
Guys, look! New treats!
We got some stones, garnet, some rose quartz, citrine. This might be blue topaz or aquamarine. We're reporting live from the Stones of the New Consciousness Conference.
The other thing that you may want to add is one of the fulgurites. That's in the little container that says F on the top. They're kind of gray ground things. That's made by the lightning strikes. So that's a prayer connector. Have fun.
He's in the video.
Well, good morning. Like the Ouroboros, we've gone all around the spiral. You were all sitting in this sort of a formation the first day. Now we're in this sort of a formation the last day. And I think like the Ouroboros, as we've been eating our own tail, we've gotten a lot of nourishment, huh? This was Stones of the New Consciousness Intensive, and we worked hard to enter the new consciousness. And you know, I want to say, just repeat so that we let it sink in, the things I think are the most salient things about what the new consciousness is. And you don't have to take notes. I mean, you can. I don't blame you. There's not much that I say that's not worth writing down, right?
No more praise for him this weekend.
That's right, yeah. She has to live with me. You know, that's actually, it's about three quarters of the way down the page. So to begin with, though, the new consciousness is a co-creating consciousness. And the very centerpiece of co-creativity is generosity. What we do when we bless the world, when we do the activity of blessing, is we generate from our heart the offering of ourself into union with whatever occurs in our world, and we invite that into our heart with gratitude. And that's the circle, that's the Ouroboros, that's the fractal spiral pattern that gets bigger and bigger and more resonant as we do it. So generosity of self. It doesn't mean you have to give away a lot of money or something. It's generosity of self towards the world, not only other people. Towards, you know, I make the joke, right? You praise the road signs and the dog dew and the rocks and the asphalt, as well as the trees and the beautiful flowers. So I think that's important. Doing serious work lightly is part of the new consciousness, because co-creation is a consciousness of joy. When everything you do in co-creative union with the soul of the world is done in a state of joy. Joy is not the same thing as happiness. Joy underlies happiness. So when you have that underlying well of joy, it's simply a matter of your heart being acknowledged and you recognizing and welcoming the participation of your heart in union with the world soul. So we just do that. We keep acting from there. We just keep going back to it. You know, we're going to forget. When you go home, you'll be challenged, I promise you. You know, because it always happens that way. When you go somewhere and you make gains, then the world says, okay, are those gains real? Do you want to have a chance to solidify and integrate those gains in the face of a challenge? We'll be glad to give you some challenges, you know? And so, you know, just interfacing with people who are not doing what you're doing will tend to drag you into the repetition of the old consciousness. So when you go home, forgive yourself instantly every time you forget, and then start again. That's all. I mean, this is me, you know, giving you my ideas, and if you like them, keep them. If you don't like them, you can just shake your head and say, that's Simmons, you know, I don't know what he's thinking. But if you like them, they're offered. So the activity of blessing is this new way of being. And the other thing I forgot to tell you yesterday is, or any of these days, is when you go outdoors, notice the fractals in the world. Notice those spirals and all those weird little fern-shaped leaves and all that other repetition of self-similar detail that betrays to you the presence of the underlying world wisdom. In other words, she lets you see her. She's right in plain sight, but she's so present that we overlook it. We overlook the activity of wisdom in the world. So when I go outside now and I see trees, I'm like, fractal, you know, everywhere. And that's wisdom. That's the wisdom, and it's also the regenerative activity. It reminds me that everything I do through being generous with myself is part of the regenerating activity of the world. So don't let yourself doubt it. When you do doubt it, remember later and say, oh, I don't doubt it anymore. But the doubt reflects right through Indra's net, just like the faith does, just like the generosity does. And there are these moments where wonderful things happen, and then we say, was that just my imagination? Or we say, well, I got to go back to the real world, things like that. So there was a poem I want to give you by Antonio Machado, and it expresses the polarity of the wonder and the doubt at the same time. Here it is. I love it so much I memorized it, hopefully. It's called Last Night. Last night, as I was sleeping, I dreamt, marvelous error, that a spring was breaking out here in my heart. Along what secret aqueduct, oh water, are you coming to me? Water of a new life that I have never drunk. Last night, as I was sleeping, I dreamt, marvelous error, that I had a beehive here inside my heart. And the golden bees were making white combs and sweet honey from my old failures. Last night when I was sleeping, I dreamt, marvelous error, that a fiery sun was giving light inside my heart. It was fiery because it gave warmth as from a hearth. And it was sun because it gave light and it brought tears to my eyes. Last night as I was sleeping, I dreamt, marvelous error, that it was God I had here inside my heart. So you feel the pull between the wonder and the doubt. If it's there, it's there. But remember that we live in a universe that is Indra's net. All the jewels, you're the jewels. We're all the jewels in the net because points of consciousness are the jewels in the self-reflecting, fractal, regenerative, infinite net of being. Every point of consciousness, every heart, every intelligence is another reflecting jewel in Indra's net. So when, because you have choice, you doubt, you go that way, doubt flows through all the jewels in Indra's net. And when you generously offer self, generosity comes flowing through all the fractal connections of the infinite web of Indra's net. When you love, love permeates the universe through Indra's net. And we can never know when it will happen, but sometime, you fluttering your wing, like the butterfly and the butterfly effect, you fluttering the wing of your love can generate a hurricane of love in some other point in the fractal net, and that will reverberate through everything else in that. So that the birth of a cosmos of love in union with the soul of the world happens through these little acts, because Sophia's universe is one in which everything is connected, and we can never tell how deeply and how powerfully our activities will reverberate through the universe. But we're responsible for everything that we do, because everything we do does go through the whole net. Don't feel guilty. It's just another bad vibe in the net, you know? Okay. So, Sophia needs us to be awake. We can't say, oh, I'm in the new consciousness now, I can go back to sleep. You know, as soon as we go back to sleep, we're out of it. So it's a creating consciousness. And you know you can't create anything if you're not awake, right? You can't make a prayer stick or a template in your sleep or any of the other things that we create. We only go to the default position of being in union with whatever a sleep consciousness is going on around us when we lose awareness and just be carried along. Remember, Rilke said, being carried along is not enough. Take your well-disciplined strengths and stretch them between two opposing poles, because inside human beings is where God learns. So that's the consciousness of the new consciousness is a consciousness of awakeness. And as long as you're awake and doing the activity of blessing in the world, you're creating with her. And, you know, we're creating with her in our sleep too, but not what we could create. Look at all the astonishing places we went this weekend. We created that. She created that with us. If we practice that with the same level of repetition that we tend to practice the stuff that we were born into, that was just around us, it'd be a new world, and will be. So that, let's see. So when you go home, your ally is Sophia. That's why I say look for her everywhere. Notice the synchronicities and realize it's her. Notice the patterns of nature and realize it's her. Notice what's going on in your own being and realize it's you and her. If I say that generosity is the key to the new consciousness, you know, that's because Sophia herself is so generous. Look at the opulent, extravagant universe that we're residing in and that we are expressions of. I mean, there's nothing wilder than the universe we already can see, except maybe the one we're going to see. So, you know, about Indra's net, you know, there's that saying of Jesus, what you do to the least of my brethren, you do to me. He's not trying to give you a guilt trip, I don't think, there. I think what he's saying is the universe is connected. When you're unkind to yourself, it sends unkindness through the net. When you're unkind to others, or doubt, or judge, or fear, it's happening to all the brethren, which is everybody. And that's, you know, I mean, it's not anything to feel bad about ever, because that's just more bad. It's just like forgive, forgive, and recognize the connection. The old consciousness of the body is fear. You know, the awareness of degeneration and death and all the other things that make us feel vulnerable means that in the old consciousness, the body has got underlying fear in the cells. And we know that that's what contracts and makes us degenerate. The old consciousness of the heart is exile because it's been shut out of its seat of sovereignty, like we talked about yesterday. The heart is the leader of our being, and if it's not allowed to lead, it's in exile. And that's generally what our world, because of fear, has done. So that's the old consciousness of the heart. And the old consciousness of the brain is falsehood. Or the illusion, or the pursuing the illusion of control, which is false. We don't have control. So, in the mind has tried to create all this control, and that is falsehood. Now, the new consciousness of the body is joy. When you're in that state of the generosity of self, and you realize you're co-creating with the soul of the world, it's joy. And your body will feel it. And that expands and brings light into those cells that are shut down in fear. The new consciousness of the heart is love and empathy. I don't think I even have to explain that. But it leads. It's wisdom. It's the part that knows what's real and true. And we follow that. We're with what's real and true. And the new consciousness of the brain is truth. Because the brain lets the heart show it what's true and acts in service to that. When joy, love, and truth combine, they become light. And that's the way to being who we are as light beings. So now we've done a lot of great work together. Remember that the labyrinth is our walk through life, and that as we walk through the physical labyrinth, the physical world, we walk through heaven at the same time. Our soul walks the labyrinth of heaven in unity and resonance with the way that our bodies walk the labyrinth of earth.
And I want to thank Bob and Kathy for being willing to step into that next step.
Wow.
To do this.